Hello everyone. This video is part of the online lecture series initiated by the Zoological Society of Assam, ZSA. In this presentation, I will be discussing about the proteins involved in initiation, elongation, and termination of polypeptide chain. Therefore, let us begin. By the end of this presentation, I am expecting that my viewers will have a thorough insight into the historical aspect of protein translation, the various proteins which are involved in the translation machinery. We shall also look into the various factors involved precisely in prokaryotic translation, along with that, the various proteins involved in eukaryotic translation machinery. We shall also explore the various similarities and differences among the two systems. Historical significance. When we discuss historical significance, the first name which comes to our mind while discussing protein translation is ribosomes, as ribosomes are the bodies which are required for conducting the translation machinery. The ribosomes were first observed in 1950s by Romanian-American cell biologist George M.N. Palade. He observed the ribosomes with the help of an electron microscope and he saw them as dense particles or granules. Because of this pathbreaking discovery by Palade, he was awarded the Nobel Prize in the year 1974. Friends, there is an image of Palade on your right hand side. While growing up, and if we study cell and molecular biology, one name which is very familiar to us is Francis Crick. So Francis Crick was the first person to suggest that tRNA or transfer RNA, which brings the amino acids for protein translation, that tRNA acts as an adapter molecule. Francis Crick is also credited for co-deciphering the genetic code along with his fellow scientists Sidney Brenner, Leslie Burnett, and R.J. Watts Tobin in the year 1961. We know that there are 20 amino acids in our body which are considered as essential, and all the proteins are made up of these 20 building blocks of amino acids. The first amino acids to be discovered was in the year 1906 in France, and it was isolated from asparagus, thus it was named asparagine. Later on, cysteine, which was isolated from urinary stones, glycine was isolated from gelatin, and leucine from muscle and wool. By the year 1935, all the amino acids that make up proteins had been discovered. When we will study about protein translation in eukaryotes, we'll come across the initiation factors, initiation factor 1F, IF1, IF2, and IF3. These initiation factors were also discovered by the year 1966. Introduction and insight into ribosomes. So friends, soon after transcription, as by the rules of central dogma, the mRNA comes to the cytoplasm from the nucleus for translation of polypeptides, and the name which pops up here is ribosome, as ribosomes are the main machinery for carrying out the entire protein translation process. Ribosomes are abundant components of both prokaryotes and eukaryotic cells. Ribosomes are also known as ribonucleoprotein, and they are named so as ribosomes consist of a protein part and a RNA part. The protein part of the ribosome is known as ribosomal protein, and the RNA part is known as rRNA or ribosomal RNA. We'll look into the details of it in the upcoming slides. Ribosomes has two subunits, one large subunit and one small subunit, and the two subunits come together to form a complete ribosome. The ribosomal subunits and their RNAs are named using a parameter called the S value. Here, the value S stands for Svetberg's unit. Prokaryotic ribosomes. In case of prokaryotic ribosomes also, the ribosomes are divided into two subunits, the small subunit and the large subunit. The small subunit is known as 30S, as it consists of 16S rRNA, which is made up of 1541 nucleotides, and it has 21 R proteins. The large subunit, on the other hand, is known as 50S, and it consists of 23S rRNA, which is made up of 2904 nucleotides, the 5S rRNA, which is made up of 120 nucleotides, and together there are 31 proteins in the large subunit. In bacteria, the 5S, 16S, and the 23S rRNA genes are organized into a gene cluster, which is linked together by the internally transcribed spacer or ITS regions. At these regions, along with the regions transcribing for the tRNAs, are conserved and are present in adjacent regions in the genome. Here we have a schematic representation of the prokaryotic ribosome. The small subunit, which is known as 30S, has the 16S rRNA. The large subunit, 50S, it has 5S rRNA and 23S rRNA. The small and the large subunit comes together to make a functional ribosome, which is known as 70S. Eukaryotic ribosomes. In case of eukaryotic ribosomes, the small subunit is known as 40S, and it consists of 18S rRNA, which is made up of 1874 nucleotides and 33 proteins. The large subunit, on the other hand, is known as 60S, and it consists of 28S rRNA, which is made up of 4718 nucleotides, 5S rRNA, and 5.8S rRNA of 120 and 160 nucleotides respectively. In the large subunit, there are about 50 proteins. In humans, the genes which encodes these RNAs are present in 5 clusters, and they are located on chromosome 13, which is known as RNR1, chromosome 14, RNR2, chromosome 15, RNR3, chromosome number 21, RNR4, and chromosome number 22, RNR5. In the diagrammatic representation of the eukaryotic ribosome, the small subunit 40S is again made up of 18S rRNA. The 60S, which is the large subunit, it consists of 28S rRNA, 5.8S rRNA, and 5S rRNA. Together, the small and the large subunit forms the functional ribosome, which is known as 80S in case of eukaryotes. In this slide, we consider the 3D structural difference between a prokaryotic ribosome and a eukaryotic ribosome. On your left hand side, there is a prokaryotic ribosome of 70S, and that is its 3D structure. On your right hand side, this is the 3D structure of 80S ribosome. From the structure itself, we can quite clearly understand that the eukaryotic ribosome is much more complex than a prokaryotic ribosome. Proteins in the activation of amino acids and attachment to tRNA. In the case of protein translation, along with ribosomes, the second most important components are tRNA or transfer RNA. As we know, the tRNA is the main component which is responsible for bringing down the amino acids to the polypeptide chain. Along with it, it also reads the genetic codes in the mRNA. It can do so as it has an anticodon end attached to it, and by virtue of which it can bring the appropriate amino acids to the growing polypeptide chain. So this entire process is catalyzed by the help of an enzyme which is known as aminoacyl tRNA synthetases. This is a very important enzyme. Aminoacyl tRNA synthetases are a group of enzymes which activates the amino acid by ATP to form an amino acid adenylate, and then it transfers the activated amino acid to the 3' end of the tRNA, forming aminoacyl tRNA. The entire process is called aminoacylation. Now, in our body, there are 20 amino acids, functional amino acids, and in case of 20 amino acids, there are much more tRNAs, as we know. And for every tRNA, we have a respective aminoacyl tRNA synthetases. Therefore, it is a group of enzymes. The reaction here, if we see, the amino acid is taken, and it is charged by an ATP to form an aminoacyl AMP, as ATP is broken down and it releases an inorganic or phosphate. This process is again catalyzed by amino acid tRNA synthetase. And in the second step, that was the first step. In the second step, the activated amino acyl AMP along with tRNA, because now the activated amino acyl AMP will be added to the 3' end of the tRNA, and it will form the amino acyl tRNA, and the AMP will be released. So this process is again catalyzed by the same enzyme amino acyl tRNA synthetase. Thus, at the end, we will be having a tRNA which is charged with the appropriate amino acid and an AMP. Proteins in prokaryotic initiation. Prokaryotic initiation is also known as eubacterial initiation, and the various protein factors involved here are IF1 initiation factor 1, IF2 initiation factor 2, and IF3 initiation factor 3. So let us look into the details of the three initiation factors. So far we know that once the small and the large subunit of the ribosome assembly is formed, then ribosome has three sites in it: A site, T site, and E site. A site is the site where the upcoming amino acid, which is attached to tRNA, it comes and joins. P site is the site where the tRNA consisting of the growing polypeptide chain is attached. And P site is also the site where the tRNA consisting of the first amino acid, amino acid which is known as formalated methionine in case of prokaryotes, comes and joins. And E site is the exit site. So it is the E site from through which the tRNA, once it submits the growing polypeptide chain to the upcoming tRNA, it leaves the ribosome assembly. So IF1 or initiation factor 1, it first binds the A site of the small ribosome and prevents the initiated tRNA from binding to the A site. So therefore, when initiated tRNA consisting of methionine, it comes to the assembly, it cannot bind in the A site as it is occupied and blocked by IF1. Then initiation factor 2, IF2, it directs the tRNA, the initiated tRNA, to its correct position in the initiation complex. And therefore, the upcoming tRNA, it comes and binds in the P site. And this is facilitated by a GTPase activity. So IF2 has a GTPase activity, and therefore it breaks down a GTP to facilitate and provide the energy for this process. And it also helps in joining the 50S subunit to generate a complete ribosome. The third factor is IF3 or initiation factor 3. It binds to the 30S subunit and prevents in the premature association of the large and the small subunit of the ribosome. Therefore, it checks that the two subunits do not attach prematurely, and it also ensures that the 30S subunit is able to bind to mRNA, and it looks into the fidelity of initiation. Proteins involved in eukaryotic initiation. During the initiation of eukaryotes, a number of protein factors are involved. One of the most important of them being EIF4F. So here E means eukaryotic, IF is initiation factor, and then 4F. So EIF4F is a heterotrimer consisting of EIF4G, EIF4E, and EIF4A. Now let us look into the individual factors. EIF4G. EIF4G acts as a scaffold protein linking the various components of the initiation complex. That is, it links the various components together. EIF4E. EIF4E is also known as a cap binding protein, and it binds the 5' cap of the mRNA. So we know that protein translation takes place from 5' to 3'. EIF4A. EIF4A acts as a helicase and unwinds any secondary structure at the 5' end. So it acts as a helicase, that is, it breaks the hydrogen bonds and helps in unwinding. Then we have EIF4B. It stimulates the RNA helicase activity of EIF4A. Therefore, together they form a complex, that is EIF4F, which is in itself a combination of all the three factors, along with the mRNA, which needs to be translated, and EIF4B. So these three of them together forms a complex, and it joins The 43 S pre-initiation complex. So what is the 43 S pre-initiation complex? We'll see in the next slide. Proteins involved in eukaryotic initiation. So the second part of proteins involved in eukaryotic initiation is very fascinating. Here what happens that we know that the small subunit of eukaryotic ribosome is known as 40S. And then we have few more initiation factors. So there's one particular initiation factor which is known as EIF3. This EIF3 helps in maintaining the 40S subunit, the free 40S subunit, small subunit. And then we have EIF2, one another initiation factor. This initiation factor, when it attaches to GTP, it becomes active. And then it goes and attaches to a charged tRNA, which is attached with, again, a methionine. So we know that methionine is the start codon in protein translation. So tRNA charged with methionine then is attached with EIF2, which is bound to GTP. And together, this is known as a ternary complex. So we have ternary complex, and then we have EIF3, which is maintaining the 40S free ribosomal subunit. So together they join and they form an activated 43S subunit. So in 43S subunit, we have EIF3 along with the 40S subunit, and then EIF2 with a charged tRNA containing methionine. And therefore we have a complete 43S subunit. Now EIF3 has another major function, that is, it later on facilitates the attachment of 60S subunit to join the complex. So the another important fact, EIF5A, this is a GTPase activating protein and it joins the 48S complex. And EIF5P, which enables the 60S subunit to join the complex and lays off with the elongation procedure. Now we have to note another important protein, which is PABP or poly A binding protein. This is associated with 3' poly A tail and it interacts with EIF4G, rendering the mRNA in a circular organization during protein synthesis. So in eukaryotes, protein synthesis, the mRNA is in a circular organization and not linear. Proteins in elongation. The process of elongation of polypeptides is conserved in both eukaryotes as well as prokaryotes. Therefore, the factors or proteins which are involved in elongation of polypeptide chain is same and conserved in both the life forms, that is in both prokaryotes as well as eukaryotes. So we have three different proteins here, EFTU, which is also known as EF1A, EFTS, which is known as EF1B, and EFG, which is known as EF2. The first factor, elongation factor, which is EFTU, it mediates the entry of the upcoming amino acyl tRNA into its correct position in the ribosome. To do so, EFTU, it first binds to the GTP. Now, once EFTU is bonded to the GTP, it is activated. It's considered to be activated. Now, this activated complex, it binds to the tRNA. And then, the GTP, which is bonded to EFTU, is broken down or hydrolyzed to form GDP. And this energy, which we get from the breakdown of GTP, helps in the binding of the amino acyl tRNA to the A site. As we remember, we've seen in previous slides that ribosome has three sites, A site, C site, and E site. So the EFT GTP, which is now broken down to GDP, and the tRNA, amino acyl tRNA consisting of the amino acyl, is attached to the A site. At this point, this EFTU is released. It is released from the complex, and the tRNA, it leaves the tRNA in the A site. And from this point, the elongation factor EFTS takes over. So the elongation factor EFTS, which is also known as EF1B, it mediates the release of the EFTU GTP from the ribosome and the regeneration of the EFTU GTP for another cycle, that is to bring another amino acyl tRNA. The third factor, which is EFG, which is also known as EF2, it is also known as translocase, and it mediates in the translocation of the ribosome along the mRNA in the 5' to the 3' direction. So, and the energy for this translocation is provided by splitting our GTP to GDP. So this is about elongation in prokaryotes and eukaryotes. Proteins in prokaryotic termination. The protein factors which are involved in termination of prokaryotes are RF1, RF2, and RF3. Here, RF stands for release factor. So, as we know that there are three termination codons, which is UAA, UAG, and UGA. And termination codons are those codons which, upon reaching by the ribosome, the synthesis of the polypeptide chain is stopped and the polypeptide chain is released. So, the release factor RF1, it recognizes the termination codon UAA and UAG. And the release factor, which is RF2, it recognizes the stop codon UAA and UGA. Therefore, together RF1 and RF2, they recognize the three stop codons, which is, and these stop codons are universal for every organism. Now, once it is recognized, like once RF1 and RF2 recognizes the termination codon, it activates the ribosome to hydrolyze the bond between tRNA and polypeptide. And after it hydrolyzes the bond between ribosome and polypeptide, the polypeptide chain is released. And the third factor, which is RF3, it stimulates dissociation of the two release factors, RF1 and RF2, from the ribosome once termination is completed. So this is about termination in prokaryotes. Proteins in eukaryotic termination. So the protein factors which are involved in termination of eukaryotic polypeptide chains are ERF1, ERF3, and there's another factor which is known as RRF. So unlike the prokaryotes, in eukaryotes, what happened is the termination factor ERF1 recognizes all the three codons. As I have mentioned in my previous slide, that the termination codons are universal throughout, which is UAA, UGA, and UAG for every group of organism. So therefore, they are also same for the eukaryotes. And in eukaryotes, the release factor ERF1 recognizes all the termination codons. The factor which is ERF3, this functions, its function is not much known so far, but one function which is known is it facilitates ERF1 in recognition of the stop codons. So ERF1 is the wholesome release factor for recognizing and halting the protein synthesis of the growing polypeptide chain. The another protein component which is important here is RRF, which is also known as ribosome recycling factor. So as we know that once the protein synthesis has been halted and the hydrolysis has been complete between the tRNA and the growing polypeptide chain, the polypeptide chain is released. But the ribosomes, the small and the large subunit of the ribosome, which is attached there, it needs to be dissociated or released. The release of the ribosomal subunit is facilitated and carried out by RRF. And it is an energy-demanding process, the energy of which is provided by the hydrolysis of GTP, that is the breakdown of GTP. So this is all about termination in eukaryotes, protein termination in eukaryotes. Translation in prokaryotes. Here we have a diagrammatic, schematic diagrammatic representation of the process of translation in prokaryotes, and we will take a quick review in it. So we can see that we have an mRNA, and as I said before, translation takes place from 5 prime to 3 prime. So in the mRNA, we have a start codon, which is AUG, and it is again universal. And we have a stop codon after a few base pairs. Here the stop codon is UAG. In between, we have codons, and the codons are read in triplicate. We have our tRNA, which has an anticodon end. This anticodon end is at par with the codons of the mRNA. So since it is AUG, so the correspondingly its anticodon is UAC. The tRNA is already charged with an amino acid, which is the first amino acid, and that is methionine. we have the two ribosomal subunits, small and large. So for the initiation to begin, the small and the large subunits comes and attaches to form a functional ribosome. It has three sites, as I said, A site, T site, and E site. So as we have already discussed, that the first tRNA, which brings the methionine, it comes and attaches to the P site, and as A site is blocked by initiation factor IF1. So we can see that tRNA has attached in its correct position, which is the P site. Now, subsequently, the elongation process takes place, and the upcoming amino acids, which is carried by the respective tRNAs according to the codons of the mRNA, are attached in the A site. And the shift is being done of the growing polypeptide chain from P site to A site. And here the various elongation factors, as discussed earlier, are mentioned. Once one tRNA, it transfers the growing polypeptide chain to the new or the latest amino acid, the tRNA, which doesn't have any amino acid on it now, it leaves the ribosome assembly from the E site or the exit site. Finally, we come to termination. And in termination, as already discussed, the release factors play its role. So termination is achieved when the stop codon is reached. And once the stop codon is read, after that, the release factor comes into motion, which hydrolyzes the bonds of the polypeptide, and it releases the mature, it releases the complete polypeptide, and the ribosome assembly is dissolved. Therefore, the cycle is repeated for as many times as. So this is about a conceptualized view of how translation takes place in prokaryotes. Translation in eukaryotes. So for translation in eukaryotes, we also have a schematic here. Here also the mRNA is translated from 5 prime to 3 prime. We have a tRNA, which is charged with an amino acid, methionine, and here the methionine is not formylated. And the initiation of eukaryotic translation is much more complex than prokaryotes. So for initiation, also we have two ribosomal subunits, 40S and 60S. But there are many factors which are involved, and during initiation, the mRNA, it forms a circular pattern, a circular motion. We have different factors coming in. The 40S subunit, it joins with the tertiary complex, ternary complex, and then it forms a 43S subunit, which finally it gives way for addition of the 60S subunit. The ribosome here also, it has the A site, P site, and E site. From elongation onwards, it is similar with the prokaryotes. For elongation, we have the same common factors, which is EFTU, TS, and EFG. For the termination, again, in eukaryotes, for termination to take place, we have one common factor, which is ERF1. It recognizes all the stop codon, and the RRF is a ribosome release factor, and it helps in the release of the ribosome assembly, that is the dissociation of the large and the small subunit. And hydrolysis is same, the polypeptide chain is hydrolyzed and released. So in translation, the only complex part is the initiation, that it takes a circular pattern, and we should remember the various factors which are involved. And this is all about translation in eukaryotes. So with this, we have come to an end to our presentation about the various proteins which are involved in initiation, elongation, and termination of polypeptides in both prokaryotes and eukaryotes. So I hope you have understood, and these are the few references and suggested reading which you can go through. These books will not only help the undergraduates, but also if postgraduate students and anybody who wants to build up a base in cell and molecular biology. The few books which I have mentioned here, which I myself have followed while preparing this lecture, is Molecular Biology of the Gene by James T. Watson, and I have followed the sixth edition. The Cell, A Molecular Approach by Geoffrey M. Cooper. I followed the fifth edition, Molecular Cell Biology by David Baltimore and Harvey Lodish. The fourth edition was available with me. And then we have Cell and Molecular Biology by D. Robertis and D. Robertis. I have followed the seventh edition. So these are some of the stalwarts and famous books in the field of cell and molecular biology. And if you follow these books, all your concepts are definitely it's going to be cleared. And you get easily you will be getting a PDF version of this in any online platform. So please refer to these books. And I hope this talk has been helpful to you. Thank you to all my viewers for your kind attention. I hope this talk has been beneficial to you. I'm very much open to feedbacks and suggestions. So if you have any kind of feedback or any suggestions, any queries, any doubts, please feel free to contact me. My name is Paromita Chaudhary. I am a research scholar at the Life Science Division of IASST Guwahati. I am a PhD scholar being registered under Guwahati University Zoology Department. Here I have attached my email ID. Along with it, I have also given the link to my ResearchGate profile. So stay tuned and contact me in any case any need arise. And a very best of luck to all of you for your future. Thank you.